Hello and welcome to my channel. My name is Rahana, if you don't know me, and today I will be covering a true crime story. Today I'll be covering a story that I think hasn't been covered on the YouTube true crime community, and I don't really know why. It was like really popular back in 2012. It made on everybody's headlines all across America. The story today that I'd like to cover is the Miami cannibalism attack, where Rudy Eugene attacked Ronald Popo and mutilated his face. Rudy Eugene was born on February 4th, 1981 at Jackson Memorial Hospital in Miami, Florida of the United States. Rudy's parents were immigrants from Haiti, and at only 2 months old, his parents had divorced each other. So when Rudy was growing up, him and his mother often attended church. They attended Bethel Evangelist Baptist Church, and he would regularly go there most Sundays. Rudy attended North Beach Miami High School, where he enjoyed playing football. While Rudy was in 10th grade, at the age of 16, he learned the truth about his father. All along, he had believed that his mother and his father were the people who were in his life, when in reality, his father had passed away when he was 6 years old, and his mother never told him that the man that she had married when Rudy was 2 years old was really his stepfather, which was, you know, world-shaking for him. He didn't know any better, and he never even knew the truth until 16 years old. But his mother recounts it as Rudy was doing fine with the news and had understood, and so had his brother. Rudy was arrested at the age of 16 for an assault. There's not much on what type of assault had occurred, but that was the first of many arrests that was to come for Rudy. Most of his arrests revolved around marijuana possession, but there was also an incident that had occurred in 2004. February 24, 2004, there was an incident between him and his mother, where at his family home, he had flipped the table and had yelled at her and declared that he would shoot her brains out. When police were called, he was not fazed by the authorities, and the officer had raised a taser at him, and he took 3 tasers to get Rudy down. After the incident, his mother had decided not to press charges, but for resisting arrest without violation, he received probation for the attack. After high school, Rudy had acquired money through different sources, such as selling CDs and working at McDonald's. And his last known employment was car washing dealership vehicles. Rudy had aspirations to open up one day a mobile car wash business. Rudy liked sports, fast cars, and action movies. By 2005, Rudy was married to Jenny DuCont, and the marriage quickly had a lot of troubles along the way. There was some domestic violence within the marriage, and police were called to the house a couple times due to incidents. With that being said, they filed for divorce in 2007, and during the year leading up to the official divorce, Rudy had came across Rakita Cross at a stoplight in Miami. He was like, "Hey girl," and she was like, "Hey," and he honked at her and somehow got her number, and they started an off and on again relationship, but overall it was said that they had a good relationship. The divorce from Jenny DuCont finalized in 2008, and at that time Rudy and Rakita Cross were living together. Even with most of the charges that Rudy had acquired throughout the years related to marijuana and possession of marijuana, he had desires to quit marijuana. He often told his friends and family that he desired to quit it. Ronald Popple was born in New York, and he had lived there and moved to New Orleans for quite some time, and then later settled within Miami. There's over 24 arrests on book for Ronald Popo. Most of Ronald's arrests revolved around trespassing, public drinking, and sleeping in public, but he also had harder charges of assault, burglary, and resisting arrest. Popo went to Jackson Memorial Hospital for a gunshot injury in 1976. Records show that Ronald was on the streets for a long period of time, ever since 1983. He listed his home address as the Salvation Army. As friends and family tried to piece together the last few hours of what happened to Rudy and Ronald, they came across this. Rudy had went over to his good friend Christian's house looking to speak to Christian, but Christian wasn't there, and he left the message with the brother saying that he really needs to speak to him. The brother noted that Rudy just didn't seem right, didn't seem himself, and that something was really bothering him. But he never got that chance to speak to Christian, because on May 26, 2012, Rudy had woken up really early in the morning and was scrummaging through the closet, throwing items all over the floor, and he had made a mess of the room. Rikita had actually woken up to this, and it seemed as though Rudy was looking for something, but it wasn't clear what he was looking for. He had told her that he is going to go meet up with a friend of his, and he had taken his King James Bible with him and a book that he often wrote his scriptures in, kissed her goodbye, and said that he'd see her later that day. An hour had passed, and Rudy had called Rikita to let her know that his car had actually broken down and that he would be taking a little bit longer to get home today. With Rikita and Rudy usually keeping in touch with each other, after a few hours of not hearing from Rudy, Rikita began to worry because she was wondering if he was still having problems getting home since his vehicle was broken down. And without being able to successfully reach him via the phone, they looked around to see if they can spot the 1995 Chevy Caprice, which was nicknamed the Purple Monster. Somehow the vehicle had made its way to the South Beach of Florida, and it just didn't really make any sense, like why he was at the beach location, and the vehicle was actually towed away. Around 2 p.m. on May 26, 2012, Popo, 65 at the time, was just chilling by the side of the freeway, the MacArthur Freeway, just off of the Herald Building, and he came across Rudy. Rudy had walked up to Popo, and it is recounted as this. Rudy had spoken to Popo saying that he couldn't score at the beach today, and he was really pissed off by it. And then he spoke and said that Popo had stole his Bible, and that's when the attack began. A bus driver had called into the police saying that two men are attacking each other on the freeway. Another passerby, a person in their vehicle named Mike, had called into the police saying that there's a man, an African-American man, tearing off his clothes, throwing it into the street, and attacking another man on the side of the road. And it seemed as though he was like eating at him. He was eating at his face. This whole ordeal was caught on highway cameras. A little bit you can see in the corner of what the events occurred, but you can't really tell exactly what happened because they're so far away. But Rudy began to attack Popo. He straddled him, took off his pants, had punched him, and had started to eat at his face. There was even a bicycle person who was walking their bike, saw what happened, and you can see them biking so quick to save themselves from what they have just seen. Miami police officer Jose Ramirez had arrived at the scene and had calmly walked out of his vehicle. He had decided to raise his weapon at Rudy because Rudy was relentless and not stopping at attacking Papo even when he was told to stop. So over 5 bullets, some sources say 5, some sources say 7, bullets were shot at Rudy and he was pronounced dead on the scene. But Papo was still alive. The videotape can show Papo's leg still moving. Papo was immediately transported to Jackson Memorial Hospital where he had severe injuries. Over 75 to 80% of his face was mutilated and destroyed in this attack, where he had lost both of his eyes due to this attack and was permanently blind. Papo gives thanks to the police officer at the scene of that day because he believes that without him he would not be alive to today. Rudy and Papo had actually crossed paths a few years ago. Since Rudy had probation, he had to do things to give back to his community, and one of those things was donating his time at the food bank. And he had came across Papo and thought that Papo was a really nice guy, thought that he had a good interaction with him and everything. And it was a surprise to know that he would do such a thing to somebody who he knows, much less do that at all. It wasn't in Rudy's character to be of that sort of violence. Rakita Cross and Rudy's family immediately learned of the news of Papo's attack and thought it was really sad because they do remember his interaction. But what thing that they found even terrified them the most was when police officers had told them that Rudy was dead. And it was 2 days after that they learned that Rudy had actually been shot because he was the person who attacked Papo. That night, when the surface came to news that Rudy had attacked Papo, his mugshot was plastered all over everywhere, a blank expression face. This was leading news and had gone viral and became a punchline attack of somebody who attacked another person and ate their face. They called it the Miami Cannibal, and soon they called the reason was because of bath salts. Bath salts is an amphetamine that is sold and found on the streets, especially in highly drug populated cities. Bath salt has an effect when taken as some reports as joy and increased sex drive and also increased likability and social interactions, but it also has some negative side effects as well, such as nervousness and paranoia and seeing things such as hallucinations. That is what the media made of it, making it seem as though he was on bath salt and that is why he had attacked Papo that day. This news became viral. Like, I remember there was memes, there were prank videos, there was everything making fun of the attack. But in reality, like, a man had gone completely blind, had his face completely mauled by another man, and that other man was shot to death. Like, it's nothing funny about that. A toxicology had occurred on Rudy, and the only thing found within his system was marijuana, and there was no signs at all that bath salt was in his system. You can play like devil's advocate and look at the fact that maybe the system in which they were testing for whether bath salt was there, it was a different variant and the system wasn't able to detect the type of drugs that Rudy was on that day, but you don't really know. So at the time, it's been over 30 years that Papo had been in contact with his daughter, and she had thought that he may have died and possibly that he may have killed himself, but this whole ordeal had reconnected them, which is kind of like a bittersweet ending to his story. Ruth, which was Rudy's mother, had a very hard time finding Rudy a funeral home to have his funeral. Over 4 Haitian churches had declined services to her because of the very, very populated news around the fact that he was on drugs and had attacked Papa, leading to the severe attack. And it took over 2 weeks, but she finally found a place where she could have service for him and lay him to rest. Let me know what you think about this case. It's kind of controversial because, in my opinion, you can play devil's advocate and you can kind of see, like, you can see the fact that he did this, right? There's surveillance video. He obviously did this crime. But, like, now the reason is, like, why did he do this crime? Was he on drugs? And the evidence shown so far is to say that he wasn't on anything other than marijuana. Let me know what you think of this case, and let me know any conspiracy theories or cases that are undercover that you would like me to cover, and I would be glad to do that. So I hope you have an excellent week and you stay safe, and I'll see you next time. Bye.